is a big, what I warned you about in the first week, that there are lectures cool in this course and lectures uncool. And I do the uncool ones. We don't have any sexy videos. No robots doing things for you. I will try to surprise you one day. I do have one video in mind, but until then, this one especially is the very unsexy lecture. It's conceptual, I'll explain that in a second. And it's really trying to clear a space for thinking. And it's basically, say in a second, it's our great problem, especially for most of you guys directly, that we cannot think in a way today except through technology, and we cannot think technology. That's the kind of problem. It's interesting for me doing this course. It's forcing me to think about technology in even more serious ways than I have previously. So I'll try to come around. And so this lecture was actually me thinking out myself much more than others. And that's why it's different to how it's described in the course. So it's a continuation of Sven's lecture, almost direct. And we're really questioning and thinking about two things. This one I've just introduced, how to think technology, which means what it's becoming, especially what it's becoming. Not what it is, but what it's becoming. And what I'm going to say to you is that what technology is, especially what it's becoming, is not what we presume it is. Even sort of in what's going to happen. But conceptually, especially, that's what I'm really saying. Second point is, of course, how we think about design, and that's going to be the subject matter of really all the rest of the lectures. Now, how means here, what I want to say in the how bit here is not just how to do it, like that magazine, how, graphic design magazine, but how we can create a free relationship to technology. Now, this seems to be vital. We don't have a free relation to technology if we are determined by it. If you're fixed by it, you're not free. We don't have a free relationship to it, I think, if we give ourselves over to it, abandon it. Like I think that Ken and Kelly does to some extent, and Ray Kurzweil. To me, they give themselves to technology in a way that is not free. You actually. And thirdly, you can't be free to technology if you see it as a magic potion. This is the critique that Morozov does of the Carnets, a great piece of polyemic which Ted suggested that I put into the reading. It's worth reading just for the sheer polyemic violence. But you can't be free to technology if you see it magic. And there's a corollary that comes out of all this, too. In that really what I'm saying, the thrust of today's lecture, is really that we have to abandon the category technology. Wipe it out, wipe it off. We don't abandon technology, small t, but we do take away technology. Why? Because the concept of technology, as I've shown you, is too much a 19th century and early 20th century. Too bound up with technology as then was to work. The concept doesn't stretch to accommodate the reality. I'm going to say that you can't think technology today, particularly digital interactive technologies, until we have a wider frame, a framework of understanding that is both wider and more focused than the word technology, that this word is actually getting in the way, just as I think today the word design gets in the way. So I think we've got to go around these words, invent a new term. That's really what I'm doing today. That's what you'll find. Now, why am I putting so much stress on the free relationship? Free relationship so that we can act in relationship to freely in relation to technology, truly freely, truly choosing it. But also because technology is now fundamentally life-changing. Now, we could say that it always has. It's always been the essential handmaiden of mankind. But now it gets right inside us, in intelligent machines, nanotechnologies, genome, genetic engineering and so on, where life changes. Technologies that will directly determine not just how we are, but who we are. And technologies where the digital technologies themselves will be shaping the world. It's no longer that you are playing with technology here and something's happening in silence here. These two things are now locked. They're locked in. What you're doing has direct implications for how we conceive something. Also, in this process, we're all in a way, there's an urgency to this free relationship because we're already here. What I'm taking from you, the next sort of 10 quotes or so, is all from Douglas Rushkoff, which is a very, very accessible text. Not the one but Rushkoff puts his finger on a few important things. I think here in this particular quotation, he's wildly exaggerating the effect of technology on the economy. Not that technology comes down and crashed our economy twice. It's Wall Street banking. But nonetheless, the important thing here is the notion of shift. The very fabric of human relationships has changed. That we do not. And technology is enmeshed in that, can't be separated from it. We have to think. Now this shift engenders real possibilities. And Rushkoff puts them into two areas. One of them which we're kind of very aware of, I think, and he calls it really the possibility of consciousness, in effect. Just as words give people the ability to pass on knowledge for what we now call civilization, he says, networked activity could soon offer us access to shared thinking, an extension of consciousness still inconceivable to most of us today. That's one. The second side, which is less developed, is possibilities not just in consciousness, but in actually new forms of action. And I think this sentence is a key one. Yep. So the possibility of transforming the operating principles of commerce and culture. Now, as soon as we say this, we can think of immediately two problems. One is that this last possibility is already obscured or at best distorted. In our economy, we tend to stress individual connection, not collective participation. The first is apolitical, the second is very political indeed, but we tend to push back down. Even though, in my view, it's way the most important task. I can't see how we can get to some form of more sustainable world without doing this. Second, despite our rush to new technology, which perhaps we adopted too quickly, Rushkoff says, it's not clear that we comprehend the world which is emerging. Of course, quite savage about this. So far, he says, we have very little understanding of what is happening to us and of how to cope with what is emerging. So he's pretty critical about our own levels of understanding where we are. We obviously do not comprehend it, he says, in a line I enjoy very much. If we think that sending text messages to producers of a TV talent show telling them which of their 10 contestants sings for 6 months is actually engaging with the technology, it's not. This isn't it. And he adds a very interesting sentence, so that you should have read it. Some of you will have read this. This is the next sentence, yeah. It's very caustic about the limits of our interactivity. When the ways in which we've been allowed to interact have been programmed for us in a game and that Rushkoff is saying, hey, watch, okay. Are we really living in an interactive society? When in a sense the modes in which you can engage are already processed for you. In fact, Rushkoff says there's a kind of inversion going on here. Instead of optimizing our machines for humanity or our systems for humanity, we are optimizing humans for systems. And we have not And he adds, not only have we not seized the capability opening within media, but for the first, our enthusiasm for digital technology, about which we have little understanding and over which we have little control, is leading us not towards greater agency, but towards less. So Rush can say, instead of increasing our capabilities and our agency, we're not. And he's very critical then about what happens. He gives three examples, almost immediately. Those of you old enough perhaps to remember the 2000 election will recognize these as hanging shards from the voting machines. Rushkoff says, we end up at, for example, three examples. One, we end up at the mercy of voting machines with black box technologies known only to their programmers whose neutrality we must accept on faith. Then he says, we become dependent upon search engines developed by companies we can only hope value our productivity over their bottom lines. The comment on this by Don Norman, cognitive psychologist and industrial designer, is this, he says. For Google, he said, advertisers are the users and you are the product. He goes further. This is Don Norman's statement. They say their goal is to gather the knowledge of the world in one place, but really their goal is to gather all of the people in the world in one place and sell them. It's Don Norman's comment. Pretty good. Third point, he says, Rushkoff. We learn to socialize and make friends through interfaces and networks that may be more dedicated to find a valid advertising model than helping us find one another. Facebook isn't really a tool for communication and dialogue and interaction and connection. It's really a tool for marketing. And this condition, what is happening to us, Rushkoff says, has inevitably, as he puts it, baleful social and subjective consequences in terms of how people view the media and how they begin to see society as a whole. If young people who saw in social networks a way to redefine themselves suddenly find now they're conforming to the logic of social networking and finding them victims of marketeers and characters and so much. Educated lay people who saw in the net a new opportunity for participation instead see the indiscriminate mashing and mixing of pretty much everything in an environment where the loud and the lewd drown out anything that takes more than a few moments. Social community organizers. We saw in social media a new safe way for people to gather, voice their opinions and effect bottom-up change. I reference recoiling the way that network anonymity is mob behavior, mercilessly attacking thoughtless responses. Now these are savvy critiques. Now I also want to say, as you're reading through a critique like this, to me, these are both critiques and in reverse, they offer design criteria. You see what I mean? And I'm actually going to set you a little project about this, about reading through texts and turning critique into design. Because each of those could be turned into a principle for design. You see what I mean? This is very important that you learn this trick of being able to see a design opportunity inside these kind of critiques. Rushkoff goes on. Haven't stopped it. Worse, he says, instead of confronting real dangers and possibilities, we face content ourselves with the apps and social networks on offer. Instead of confronting the real dangers and possibilities that we face, we content ourselves with the apps and social networks on offer. Activities that help distract us from becoming challenging. So what Rushkoff is saying is basically what you're all doing is enjoying yourself. Really, a rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic, not quite realizing we're about to sink. It's basic. We are kind of diverting us, fiddling while Rome burns. And he concludes this section. A A society that looked at the internet as a path towards highly articulated connections and new methods of creating meaning is instead finding itself disconnected, denied deep thinking, and drained of enduring values. That's a pretty powerful design. So, good, powerful. Rushkoff's question to himself and others is, does it have to be that way? And he answers optimistically, perhaps even too optimistically. He says no. And gives one, in a sense, key answer. For him, the key answer. If we learn the basis of new technologies we're using and become conscious participants in the way they're deployed, man, there's an awful lot contained in here. Just learn. I think actually the original sentence had the word simply in it. I think it actually says simply. I think I erased it. It doesn't write at all. It's not going to be simply learn. It's very difficult to learn this. But learn means here, obviously, not just the techniques, but thinking it through, thinking this through. Now, let's think this, try and think Rushkoff one stage further. Thinking about how you can actually do this brings up a really interesting issue with the fundamental tension that we are dealing with. Rushkoff himself, if you look through his book, has two levels of strategy. One is his little book is subtitled, I think, Ten Commandments for the Digital Age. A very bad pun on Ten Commandments. I actually don't think the commands are in some ways quite as interesting as, in a sense, four strategies. One is already mentioned. Participation, program, be programmed, or what he says more softly, but in some ways really interesting, accepting our role as our program's true users. It sounds very soft, but the more you think about it, the stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger. But we are, in fact, the program, the technology's true users. We cannot be subordinate to it. Second, the need for qualitatively different strategies, even those used in the media in the past and let alone in relation to technology. Why qualitatively different strategies? The answer, because what we're dealing with today is neither a technology nor a media. It's not the same as film, TV, advertising. It's not quite a distributed media. It's not quite what we used to call a communications media, which was always a bit of a false idea anyway. Something else, qualitative, different. Third point, the capability to utilize and draw on our humanness. Very, I mean, the trouble with this word is, in terms of the word language, human, humanism, is how on earth you make it real and concrete and not simply kind of abstract. Nonetheless, Rushkoff is insisting. That's what it's got to be. But it's got to be in some ways, we've got to be able to get this back concretely. Fourthly, to seize the capabilities of those technologies. Now, these are very general strategies, as we've said, but what I want to focus on for the next few minutes is the tension between these last two, between the third and the fourth, between the capability to utilize and draw on humanness and to seize the capabilities of these technologies. I think this one, as we tease this out, we'll see something emerging. Now, Rushkoff himself solves this tension in a rather interesting way. He has a very interesting quote, page 21, where he talks about the capability of programming as extending human agency through a new linguistic or communication system. We're not just doing that, he says, it's something more. We're replicating the very function of cognition through external human mechanisms. We are creating, he says, in effect, a new human code. There's a longer quote, but it's worth you reading. Now, I think that's actually really interesting. This is, in fact, a design premise widened out. Programming can include configuration, for example. One that binds together technology, ethics, and subjectivity in very, very interesting ways. But before we could do a whole, you know, very good studio, just focused on this. But before we presume this kind of solution, let's look a bit further into this possible tension between these, because I think there is an inherent tension between these two things. Let's try an example. Let's try and something to do. Now, one answer to my idea that there is a tension between these two things is to say, no, there isn't. That there is no tension, in fact. This is the argument that says that man, that technology is naturally wedded to the human and vice versa. In Mazarov's written view, I think it's page 4 of that review, he gave three great quotations in that page about this binding together of technology and man. Here are two of them. Man without technology is not man. We are as autonomous with regard to technology as we are with regard to language, oxygen, or gravity. The only point to note about this quote by Virbach is that language is internal to us as human beings. Oxygen and gravity are external conditions. The question is, where does technology flow in between us? Something to ask about here. But basically, Virbach is saying we are bound to technology. And we can take some absolutely obvious examples of this historically. Here is an absolutely basic technology, the stirrup, a fundamental invention. The historian Lynn White said it was one of the fundamental inventions because it changed European civilization. Once you'd invented the stirrup, you could fight on horseback much better than you could. Horses were not then used to transport you to battle, they became agents of battle because you had your arm free. You could hack away there to carry it, happily doing it. But you can see that the stirrup is a direct answer to a perceived bodily need. It's not a device that makes any